Okay. Good evening and welcome to the ABCs and 1-2-3s of Back to School Basics. I'm Shelly Meitzler, the Director of Outreach and Support, and joining me tonight is our newest member to the Community Programs team, Elizabeth Skufca, Community Programs Manager. Elizabeth joined the organization and came on board in June, so we're super excited to have her. Just a little background about Elizabeth. She brings a wealth of experience working with young people and families from her career as a middle school math teacher. Her passion is to help others find the resources they need to truly thrive. Elizabeth earned her Bachelor of Science in Elementary Education and Master of Arts in Teaching degrees from Louisiana State University, and she lives with her husband, Alex, in Covington, Louisiana. If you can move to the next slide. So just to let you know, this webinar is being recorded. So by participating in the webinar, you have consented to the recording and future distribution. The camera setting by default has been turned off for all participants. We do encourage you to participate on camera if you feel comfortable doing so. But if you do not wish to be on the recording, please keep your camera off throughout the presentation. So we're going to go through some of the slides, and then from that point, we'll open it up to question and answer. If you have any questions, you can certainly drop them in the chat along the way, or when we get to the end and open it up for that Q&A, if you have any questions, you can ask them verbally as well. Okay, next slide. Okay, so we're going to talk first, kind of set the stage a little bit. We recognize back to school is a busy time. It comes pretty fast getting through summer. It flies by. So people are starting at different places, as back to school begins. So for some families, there may already be things like an IEP, which is an individual education program in place, or potentially a 504 plan. So we just wanted to refresh everyone's understanding and kind of explain the difference between the two. So an IEP focuses on educational benefits, whereas a 504 plan is geared towards ensuring a student has equitable access to the learning environment. Both are at no charge to the families, but they have kind of different things that they follow, where IEPs have more specific benchmarks and things that they're looking at, timelines, evaluations, and things like that. It's not the same necessarily with a 504 plan. So IEPs really fall under what is our federal special education law for children with disabilities, which is the Individuals with Disabilities Education Act, oftentimes referred to as IDEA or IDEA. Section 504 of the Rehabilitation Act comes from 1973, and this is more a federal civil rights law to stop discrimination against people with disabilities in general. So for an IEP, this is an individualized education program that is a written plan for services for the education of students who are disabled or gifted. So the diagnosis of TSC alone doesn't necessarily mean that a student will qualify for an IEP. So there are actually two criteria that must be met for an IEP. One of those qualifying 13 disability categories that are defined by the IDEA, and they must also need special education, specially designed instruction to receive educational benefit. So some of the different qualifying disabilities can be intellectual disability, speech or language impairments, autism, traumatic brain injury. Sometimes for individuals with TSC, it'll classify under other health impairments, specific learning disabilities. But again, that would all be determined based off of evaluations to see if the individual met those two criteria for an IEP plan. Next slide, please. So a 504 plan really provides services for a child with disabilities that's shown to substantially limit his or her educational performance. So this can include physical or mental impairment that substantially limits major life activities. And major life activities can include caring for oneself, performing manual tasks, walking, seeing, hearing, speaking, breathing, learning, and working. Many times with 504 plans, you can see this with individuals that have epilepsy, which we know is common in TSC. They may have epilepsy, but not have specific learning needs that qualify them for that IEP. But that 504 plan would still be set up to meet the needs of the epilepsy. It covers things like absenteeisms from school specific to those health concerns. For some, it would be just modifications in a classroom, whether it be extended time for tests or for assignments, or maybe where they sit in the classroom. For students who use wheelchairs, it would be allowing them ample time to leave class at the beginning or the end to avoid time navigating back and forth. Sometimes for students who are under a doctor's care for depression or anxiety, frequent behavioral problems, things like ADHD. So the student is given that additional time for different assignments or tasks, or even allowed to kind of get up and move about the classroom if sometimes sitting for those long periods of time might be challenging for the student. Next slide. So if you already have an IEP or a 504 plan, you may be familiar with this, but this also will discuss evaluations for anyone. Anytime there's a concern with a child's academics, behaviors, and or both, an evaluation for special education can be requested, and that will determine if the child has a disability and, again, needs that specialized instruction and support, remembering that we need those two criteria for IEPs. So many times this is referred to as a comprehensive multidisciplinary evaluation, a full or comprehensive evaluation. Sometimes they call it an IEP, school or team evaluation. And what this does is it includes a lot of different tests, standardized tests, behavioral observations, interviews with parents, caregivers, teachers, medical examiners. You're really utilizing all of the different assessments so that the experts, typically school psychologists, are administering many of these tests and reading the results of them. But it allows them to assess your child's cognitive abilities, language development, motor skills, social interactions, and emotional functioning. So if there's someone that has an individual that is concerned with any of the academics or behavioral performance of the school, in order to request an evaluation, the parents or caregivers must make that request in writing to the appropriate school personnel to initiate the process. And typically when we're reaching out, we're including very specific information and our concerns surrounding the need for an evaluation. Because again, a TSC diagnosis alone doesn't automatically qualify a student for special education services or even for a 504 plan. So in that information, you want to confirm and follow through that the request has been received and ask when you'll receive a permission to evaluate. So even when you put that request in writing, what happens next is a form comes home for you to sign to actually begin the evaluation process. And once you sign off for those evaluations to begin, typically takes about 60 calendar days in most states for that to be completed. Upon completion of those evaluations, the team would come together to regroup to go over the results of those evaluations. And from there, potentially, it may result in an IEP being written or a 504 plan, or it may be deemed that the child does not qualify for either one of those services. If at any point, you know, anyone has any questions or concerns as you're navigating these different pieces of the education system, our team is here and able to help with all of the various ways that you're navigating. So you can always reach out to us with any questions or concerns specific to your situation. Next slide. Okay. Next, we just wanted to talk about seizure action plans and seizure emergency plans. So as many of you may have experienced and understand, seizures are medical emergencies. We encourage any family that has an individual that has epilepsy, even if it is controlled, that you have a seizure action plan. And what that is it's a guideline that's tailored on how to respond during a seizure based on the student's medical history. So it'll include things like health and medical information that are specific to the student, as well as allow specifically staff and those that are caring for the student through the school day to recognize seizures and understand and know what the appropriate steps are to take to keep him or her safe from injury or damage that can be caused by prolonged seizures. If you've previously developed a seizure action plan with your child's neurologist, typically the school's looking for that to be updated annually, where you're looking again, noting if there's been any changes, but updating at least annually and making sure that your school nurse specifically has a copy of that. Going back to school is always a good reminder to review and update that seizure action plan. And with that, approximately 30% of our individuals diagnosed with epilepsy often have refractory or treatment resistant epilepsy, which means that many of the medications that they take don't always control seizures. And so they may experience prolonged seizures, status epilepticus, and or seizure clusters, which may need to have medication to help intervene with that seizure. So in addition to the seizure action plan, the seizure emergency plan will help the students, team, caregivers know again what to do when that emergency occurs. They'll understand when to intervene with the medication, if you should be calling 911, what those protocol are. And again, this is something you would review with your neurologist and have attached. A seizure action plan does not have to only be if you have an IEP. This can be, again, for any student that has epilepsy. It's really important that they have the most up-to-date information. We have a lot of resources at the end of this webinar that we will provide, and part of that is through the Seizure Action Plan Coalition. Those resources are linked in the presentation, and that was actually a coalition that began in 2020 with the LGS Foundation, Dravet Syndrome Foundation, and the TSC Alliance. Those organizations recognized that there was an opportunity to bring epilepsy communities together to make sure that there was awareness around seizure action plans for people with epilepsy. So those three organizations served as the governing organizations of the coalition through 2022. It's now being overseen and managed by the Epilepsy Alliance of America. But again, there's a lot of great resources that we've linked here that you can utilize for your school team if it's helpful. Next slide. Okay, I'm gonna turn it over to Elizabeth.
So some other items to consider and to think about as we're getting back to school and navigating these different experiences for all of us is your rights as a parent or guardian. You know, you have a right to ask questions and to understand, you know, what they're talking about, the different, it's okay to ask questions is basically what I'm trying to say. You have the right to understand what they are saying, what they're providing, and what they are doing. In addition to that, you have the right for open communication with them. You have the ability to ask questions and to ask for clarification and to even share, you know, this is going on at home, you know, is this at school? So just keeping that communication open between you and the school and the teachers. And even if you have an IEP, your IEP planning team. It's important that you, or not important, but it's beneficial to you and your child if you go forward earlier with your concerns, like Shelly was saying, sending an email with all of the details and the specifics of, you know, this is going on and I've gotten feedback from this teacher about this, you know, maybe evaluation could be an item that we look into. So just going forward with your concerns early so that way you can get your child the support and help that they need. Next thing on there is our paper trail, which is super important in documenting what's going on in your child's life and their education. Paper trail just means it's documentation, emails, evaluations, progress reports, anything that is proof or evidence of, you know, learning or struggles or just communication with the school. It's good because it helps you be able to reflect back, you know, oh, when did I send this to so-and-so? Or, you know, I know they mentioned a strategy. Let me go back and find it. So it helps you having that documentation. It's also helpful if, you know, down the road you need to say, you know, you aren't providing these things that you said you were. So on that route as well. And then from a teacher's point of view, just as personally, like Shelly mentioned, I was a teacher and dealing with students who had 504 plans and IEPs and different accommodations, just some things that I have gained from my experience. One being, like I mentioned before, open communication. When you're communicating with your teachers, telling them, you know, what's going on, it can help them see how or why your child is acting or doing the things that they are in class. And maybe they need a little more support, you know, with this week or, you know, this assignment. Sharing your child's likes and dislikes, their strengths, their weaknesses, highlighting those things that you are an expert on your child and their journey with TSC and their learning journey. So any information that you can share with your teachers is very beneficial, because, you know, they might really like, I taught math and I had a student who really liked dealing with sports stats, and his parents didn't tell me until halfway through the year. And when I got him into that, he was like really into the math then, but whereas before he wasn't. So it's just finding those connections that can really help your teacher, help your child. And then in saying with that, just going to your teacher with respect and listening and also asking for their input can be very beneficial too, because they're with your child a lot of the day. So just keeping the lines of communication open. How to reach us at TSC Alliance. So we, like Shelly said, are here to help you navigate if you need help with IEPs or educating teachers who don't understand things about TSC, different experiences like that. These are all hyperlinked, but I'll show you a few, like our IEP form. You can give us all your information and it'll be sent to Shelly and I to review, and we can help you with any questions that you have, or, you know, what to expect going into an IEP, or I have a question about this, or I don't feel heard this. That's what we're here for. And this is a great way to get in contact with us. Also, I put our emails there as well. You can always reach out that way too, with any concerns or questions that you have throughout your school year or your process preparing for your school year. Like Shelly said, here are some of our resources. I'm not going to go through all of them super closely because you will be sent them, but I'm going to kind of touch on them briefly to say what their benefits are. So I'm going to start with our navigation guides. Those are through TSC Alliance. I've linked three of them. And in there, they go and kind of review what we talked about in this webinar, what Shelly touched on about parents' rights and IDEA and the IEPs 504. So it just goes more into depth on that. And you have it more in a all together in a different format. Over here, we have our TSC Navigator, which also has good supports and things and resources that you can use. Finding your parent centers. So each state, if we click on this, you can look at each state and see where parents' centers are. And they have a lot of good resources to help you navigate the special education. For example, I'm in Louisiana and I have personally used Families Helping Families, and they have great free webinars and information. So this is just a website to get you connected to those resources in your state and your area. We also linked the Department of Education, and it has more information about IDEA, your IDEA by state, and many different resources there. And then we're going to email this one, but it's a Tandon Education publication. It's a PDF, and it gives you the visual of the umbrella of TAN and the different behaviors and things that fall under that TAN umbrella, just so you can kind of be able to say, oh, you know, this connects to this. And then lastly, the understood.org. They have great resources and videos that I've personally used too about, you know, how to prepare for an IEP meeting. And they are written and given from experiences of parents who went through this experience, or educators, or sometimes even both. So they have a lot of good resources and helpful information on their websites as well. So I think we're going to open it for questions or.
Shelly, hi. This is Sparky Davids. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Well, we're coping and doing well. We're just a lot of days of summer, and
yes,
we're getting our summer vacation. Wonderful presentation. I can't tell you how much it means to be able to have these resources that were not known to me previously. So this is good information for me.
Okay.
Our son was diagnosed early at 6 months, and he's just a year and a few months old, about 18 months old. And his brother's going to be 4. He does not have TSC, and he's going to be going to school. It made me think of at what age should I be thinking of these plans as he goes into it? 3.5 pre-K, I guess. And how should I be thinking about this? How should I approach this? Where should I start?
Yeah, absolutely. So that's a really good question. One thing that is really fantastic, and it's nice to give that kind of encouragement and reminder to families. You're set up. I saw the message come through in the chat. So you're set up with your Early Steps program. For those that may not be familiar, sometimes it's called Early Interventions. It has a lot of different names, but basically it's that birth to 2 or 3, depending on the state. So you actually are already set in a really great place in that prior to school age, where you potentially are set up on an individualized education program, you're currently set up with what we call an IFSP, which is an individualized family service plan. So a lot of those supports and things that are coming through right now with the county, what they'll actually do with you, and again, this may be slightly different state to state, but ideally the guidelines say that by the age of 3, when they would transition into that 3 to 5 program, they'll actually have a meeting with you, with your family and the team, and they'll bring everyone together and look at what supports and services, where they are in terms of their goals, and what you'll need from that birth, that 3 to 5 program. So they'll actually help you potentially with those next steps of that evaluation that will lead you right into potentially that IEP. So they'll be doing that basically automatically for you, and you'll be a part of those conversations to determine what that's going to look like. And for many families, having those early interventions really helps that transition into kindergarten, because if you've had those services up until pre-K or kindergarten, chances are if an IEP was needed, it's already established. And so it's a matter of transferring into kindergarten. Yes. Yeah. So it's really nice because they're watching too, and they have similar timelines that they'll do those evaluations and be able to get those services set up and really talk to you about what that transition looks like prior to kindergarten. So you still get to have the evaluations. It's just that technically you've already had an initial evaluation to get set up with those Early Steps program in your state, which are wonderful resources. It's one of the first things that we always encourage all of our families that make contact with us, especially the newly diagnosed as well. The earlier those interventions are in there, the better. They help, you know, track milestones, but help you get connected to many services that then get you set up and ready for that transition into kindergarten. So you guys are on the right track with everything you have in place.
Perfect. One other, if I may, corollary on this same track of how do I intervene? this is the A through the state. Are there private areas that I should be researching? Where could I start researching maybe additional resources that that would actually add to his treatments and not necessarily be the same, just from a different perspective? So in other words, can I be doing more? Is there a private side of these programs that I could be reaching out to? Are there institutions or organizations to do that? Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. I think, you know, so the state programs are actually really the best place to start. That's not to say that, you know, for some families, in terms of whomever you're seeing for like the overall TSC care, your care team, the neurologist, sometimes pediatricians or developmental pediatricians, you know, there may be additional extra services that you could potentially get from the private side of things, where it would still be billed through the insurance, but you could get additional like physical therapy, occupational therapy. I will say that, you know, it's not necessarily about doing more though. Typically with the IFSP plan that you have in place, if the team felt that additional services were needed, they should have already made those recommendations to you. But, you know, again, you can always, I would say from that perspective, any socialization though that we can expose our kiddos to, TSC or non-TSC, I think just giving them those opportunities. So, you know, if it's like play dates or little play groups, things like that, I would just encourage socialization, even at parks and things like that. But not necessarily that you have to seek out additional. And that's what's really good about these programs is they really identify what the needs are and make recommendations for those supports and services to really ensure that you're getting all the supports that you need, not only for your child, but also for the family, that you have all of the supports you need as you're kind of navigating this system.
Oh, good. Yeah. So that makes you feel much better because you always look at saying, yeah, you don't feel like doing something, we're missing something. So that I'll think of that, that social vision, that play date theme, I think great and if you're involved with that. Yeah, so that's good. Thank you. I will definitely touch base with our neurologist and pediatrician and your team. I think Dr. Thiel is a great physician. He really helped us out quite a bit up in Boston. So,
Good. Okay. Yeah. And as you're, you know, as you're kind of navigating those next steps, and, you know, as Elizabeth had mentioned too, you know, we recognize, you know, that's two of my three children have TSC as well. So I'm very familiar with the journey personally and the trials and tribulations of navigating the medical complexities, as well as, you know, the supports and things that they need in the education system. So even if everything's going great, you know, if there's any questions you ever have, or you just want someone else to look over things, we're happy to do that. You know, one of the other things where Elizabeth had talked about, you know, we help families, we attend IEP meetings, you know, we really want to be a resource to the families as well as the schools. But even as you're, you know, navigating transitions into different programs and things like that, we also offer at no charge to anyone what we call a TSC 101 training, where we can connect with people on the team, you know, whether in early interventions or in the school system, and just help answer some questions. That tandem publications guide that Elizabeth talked about, okay, is really good because it's very focused to educators to kind of help talk through some of the challenges or things that they may see in the classroom. And not only do we have that, but we also have volunteers throughout the country that are educators themselves or speech therapists, like school psychologists, and they're always more than welcome to talk to the school teams as well. So if there's anything we can ever do, no matter what it may be, it's always great to reach out to us, because there's a chance that we'll be able to help and then connect the team with some additional resources that just make it a little easier. We found along the way that, you know, many people, they appreciate understanding the complexities of TSC and just knowing that there are resources and support for the family and for the staff. So any way that we can help with those things, and just even understanding the vernacular that you begin to learn as you're navigating, you know, IFSP plans and IEP plans. So don't ever, you know, hesitate if we can look it over for you and just, you know, help in any way. That's, you know, really one of the passions of both of us, and just making sure that families know that they're supported through the journey. And it's not that teachers don't mean well and educators don't mean well. It's just, it's a lot to navigate. And sometimes if we don't know what to ask for or what your child's entitled to, we don't always get that information up front. So we are able to help navigate that, make sure you're getting what's appropriate and what's needed, as well as helping to ask some of those tougher questions so that the relationship with you and your school team is always maintained as well.
Oh, I'm so glad you said that. Terrific. That feels just better, because there is just that void that it's unexpected. And so we didn't know that this was going to happen. So we weren't really prepared. And we're just coming up to speed with all, like you said, vernacular, the terms and how to deal with it. So it's very, I can't tell you how much it's appreciated. It's great to hear this. So the presentation is important to us. Thank you.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And thank you for joining us. And we'll have this available. The recording will be on our website, as well as we'll distribute the PowerPoint with all of the different links and that TANS publication. Our contact information is on there as well. But yes, if we can assist in any way, please don't hesitate to reach out. We'd be happy to help.
Well, thank you. That's awesome. I would feel like that, you know, I got notes.
All right. I don't think there's any other questions. So with that, we'll give you back some of your evening, but thank you again for the engagement, for joining us, and for the questions. We truly appreciate it, and wish you all a happy, healthy school year, whatever that looks like in your area.